Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Can you hear my voice?
Waalaikumsalam.
Waalaikumsalam. Yes, doctor.
Okay, good. Today, inshallah, we are going to continue chapter 5. We almost finished chapter 5 in the last lecture. I believe that the last slide that we already discussed is this one. So good. Okay, this one. About company value webs. So let's see directly to the figure to illustrate internet enabled value web. So this figure gives you a good illustration about the how the internet technology enables the company to create an enhanced value web in cooperation with their strategic alliance and partner companies, customers, direct and indirect suppliers. So this diagram showing how the company or industry transact with several value chains outside the company. So this diagram show you the cloud labeled company or industry in the middle, connected by two-way arrows to four other clouds surrounding the company. So the company has an ERP systems and also legacy systems. Legacy systems are the existing systems beside the ERP systems, running specific to the industry or the company. The first cloud represents strategic alliance partner companies. The second cloud represents customers who are connected to the companies, to the company through the customer relationship management or the CRM system. The third cloud, it represents indirect suppliers or MRO. And the fourth cloud is direct suppliers who are connected to the company through supply chain management, such as private industry networks and marketplaces. So in this chapter, you are learning about several strategies in the business. We already discussed that the strategy is like a plan for achieving superior long-term returns on the capital invested, which is profit, the money. There are five strategies in general. In specific, there are more others. The first strategy is product service differentiation to make it different from other competitors. The second strategy is cost competition to reduce the cost to make it survive in another price also and more profit. The third strategy is the scope of the product or the service, and then the fourth one is the focus or market needs, and then the last one is customer intimacy to in the CRM system, customer relationship management. So this e-commerce relies fully on the technology, so that's why you can see several technologies discussion here. And because of this technology, then the business model also occurring the disruption through the because of disruptive technology. Disruptive means they are stopping the technology and create a new one. like technology of 2G. For example, now it, no one's using 2G, they are using at least 3G. Or maybe digital disruptions. Not just technology, but specific to the digital. Digital document, digital technology, digital approach, digital system. And also about sustaining technology which is surviving through some new improvement. So these three factors create the business disruptions through several stages. The first stage, disruptors introduce the new products with the lower quality. Second stage, disruptors improve the products. And the third stage, the new products become superior to the existing products. And the last stage, incumbent companies lose the market share. It's actually, these stages are not in common to long time ago. It's already done by several business, not only e-commerce, to dominate the market, to enter the market using the same strategy, the same stages. But with this disruptive technology, then the stages become easily identified. So you can see from this video how to apply several strategy in the business. And as usual, you can answer some questions to get more bonus points for your score.
What I love about Groupon is they encourage me to go out and try new things in the city.
I've lived here for 27 years and I'm finding new restaurants and activities that I've never done before.
The experience of Groupon was just unimaginable. Groupon started from one city, one local deal, which was with Motel Bar.
I'm not sure that our 2-for-1 pizza deal was a cornerstone of their success necessarily, but it worked.
I remember the first time I was out at a restaurant and somebody handed in a Groupon that they wanted to use, and they're like, oh my god, I can't believe someone's using a Groupon. From there, caught on. From one customer to nearly 45 million. From 10 employees to over 11,000. Groupon's now over 1,000 cities in 48 countries worldwide. That is staggering.
I did take a big risk in pursuing what I loved. I knew how to run a boat, I knew how to run a crew, I knew how to things. I had no idea how to get one person to step onto the boat. We turned the Groupon. Within a week, we had sold 1,300 seats aboard the boat. Groupon rescued our business.
We did a Groupon deal, 2 burgers, 2 fries, 2 drinks. That brought new customers, people that probably would never ever hear about us. So it was absolutely amazing.
We talk to other restaurateurs every day, and they're telling us, oh, it's a little bit slow. Like, we'll do a Groupon.
A lot of us work on so many deals that it can be easy in the midst of the daily grind to forget that the merchant that you're working on right now, for them, this is their time to shine. It's really on us to put the passion into every single merchant.
I open the door in the morning, they bring the clients in, and we go to rest.
To me, what's most exciting is where we're at today at this moment in time. We've expanded into product with Groupon Goods, we've expanded into hotels and vacation packages with Groupon Getaways, into live events with not a high-end product, Groupon service. Groupon is playing a very important role enabling the connection between merchants and customers that otherwise would never happen.
We're trying to get every local business connected to the sort of one marketplace where consumers can come search for what they want at a local level.
We're building the world's first local commerce platform, and we have the technology talent. I'm just deeply passionate about that mission. I want to be here every day working. As more and more people conduct business via the smartphone in their pocket, Groupon is better situated than anybody to take advantage of that. Our business is designed for mobile. It's highly curated. There are deals. It knows where you are and what's around you. Scroll through it and see if there's anything amazing.
Half or more of our deals are purchased by people who are going to the site and saying, I want to buy something, I want to do something. Let's go see what's on Groupon first.
If we're not cooking, I'll like run over the computer just to see what kind of deals they are.
We also have now been building these fantastic tools for merchants to basically help them run their business.
Things like a point of sale system and a payments processing system for small businesses, sort of the gamut of what any business might need if they were starting up.
All their inventory is now in our system. It's searchable, browsable, discoverable, and you can have that locally delivered or pick it up at a retailer nearby. We want to be the place consumers start when they want to buy anything, anytime, anywhere.
Even though this is a global organization and it's thousands of people, we're still building.
Every day on Groupon, there are over 100,000 things you can do, explore, places you can eat. We have tens of millions of customers and hundreds of millions of subscribers. The possibilities of Groupon at this point are almost endless. And every day we come to work, we're still in the middle of this unbelievable journey.
Okay, I'll give you 5 minutes to answer these 3 questions. Okay, good answers. Now let's go to the next slide. Oh, we finished the slide. So at the end of this chapter, you can have more options for working in some companies as an assistant manager of e-business, because you already have the knowledge. You just need to improve your skills and experience. Maybe if you are working in the big company, they will train you as a trainee. So that's all for chapter 5. So let's go move on to the chapter 6. So this chapter 6 is about e-commerce marketing and advertising. To have more specific details of the strategy that we learned in the chapter 5. So there are 4 objectives at the end of this chapter that you have to master on. The first one is able to understand the key features of the internet audience, basic concept of customer behavior and purchasing, and how the consumers behave online different from offline. So here you have to be able to explain more about the key features. And then the second objective is that you need to identify and describe the basic digital commerce marketing and advertising strategies and tools. So identifying is just memorizing, but describe is the same as understanding. So you have to explain more also this second objective. The third objective is that you need to identify and describe the main technologies that support online marketing. Because you are in from IS department, that you should be able to master the technology, right? Compared to the IS department from the business faculty. The last objective is that you need understand cost and benefit of online marketing communication. So you have to be able to measure the cost benefit that you invest to the communication strategy. So all of these objectives are understanding and describing. So you have to be able in this chapter to have a lot of explanation in the exam or in the assignment related to this chapter. So we will start from the consumers online, where they who are the consumers, and then from these consumers in detail you have to learn about the audience of the internet and also their behaviors. So we learn from the US. We don't have the book from Middle East, especially from Saudi Arabia. So the data in US is there are 280 million accesses of the internet in the US in 2018. And the growth rate has slowed because it reached almost the peak of the internet, because everybody is almost accessing the internet, still like in Saudi Arabia. But the intensity and the scope of using is increasing. They are more intense, and they have more options in their internet access. And then if you see the pattern of this internet access, you can see several demographic criteria that has that have much higher percentage of the online usage based on their incomes, their education, their age, and their ethnic dimensions. So if you divide the proportion in each of these demographic criteria. There are two main types of the internet access. They can use broadband or mobile, which give you a different behavior in the next slide. So with the broadband access, there is a significant inequalities, and usually They are accessed by older adults, lower income, lower educational levels. I mean, this one should be, this one not broadband. Broadband is more expensive, right? And then inside the house, the non-broadband, they are using the mobile access through their mobile phone or maybe from other locations. There is a community effect that the role of social emulation in consumption decisions create the connectedness. You can see from the pattern, there are 10 until 15% are more independent. And then middle 50%, they are sharing more purchase patterns of the friends. And then through this community effects, there is a recommendation system which gives the co-purchase networks. Based on the identification of the consumer online, you can analyze the behavior models. You can study the customer behavior or through some theories in the social science discipline. So the theories are usually attempting to predict the wide range of the customer decisions. After that, after this prediction, they will explain their analysis based on the background demographic factors and other intervening and more immediate variables which influence their consumption decisions. So this profiling is very common, not only for the online, in the offline also we have determining to identify the pattern of buying in the supermarket, in the shop. Right. But for online, it becomes easier to access the data. Right. And then the reason why they access this online purchase, that's because the shop online is more convenient than the offline shop. Right. So based on this reason, should be the groundbreaking of mining the profiles of, because it's main division of the online shopping. So this figure gives you the customer behaviors model. So this which try to predict the decisions that the customer make in the marketplace. You can see this from the source from the Kotler and Armstrong from the book of Pearson Educations 2009. The title is Principle of Marketing. So this image gives you a general model of the consumer behavior. So the text is illustrating from left to right, which is illustrating the general model of the consumer behavior that influence the customer marketplace decision. So the image show you the independent demographic variables, which is leading to intervening variables, which in turn lead to the dependent variables. So if you are doing the quantitative research, usually we have a dependent independent variables. If you are the distributing the questionnaire in the surveys, then you will identify this kind of variables. So this independent demographic variables includes several background factors such as cultural factors, social factors, psychological factors, and then the intervening variables such as market stimuli, social networks, and communities, including the brand, marketing, community, communication stimuli, and the company's capability. Then the dependent variable consists of in-store behavior and buyer decision. So this kind of an input. Just the dependent variables is like an output that you want to identify based on the input and demographic variables influence the dependent variables that you want to measure. And the output is buying or not buying. In the store, you are browsing, or how many minutes that you stick on browsing, searching. So those kind of variables that you want to identify as pattern through the data mining technology. To decide the online purchasing, there are several stages in the consumer decision process. The first stage is awareness of the need. They know they need something, not just wasting time for you to be online, but they have something to buy. After that, they will search for more information, and then they evaluate some alternatives. So that's why a good e-commerce, they provide a technology to compare one by one at two products based on the price, the specification, and so on. After that, when they make a purchase decision, this is the fifth stage. And this is not the end of the decision process. The last one might be after sales service. There is a post-purchase contact with the company regarding the product, giving the reviews, complaining, returning the products. All of this should be part of customer decision process. So you can see from the figure illustrating all those processes, giving you illustration that the customer decision process and supporting communications. The customer decision process and the type of the offline and online marketing communication that support the process. The first step is awareness, need recognitions, online marketing communication that support awareness, need recognition include targeted display advertisement, targeted email advertisement, social media, offline marketing communication that support awareness, need recognition include mass media, TV, radio, print media, and social networks. And the second step is the customer decision searching. So the online marketing communication that support the search includes search engine, usually either outside of their website, the application, or inside the website application. The online marketing communication that support search also includes online catalogs, site visit, targeted email, and social networks. The offline can be catalogs, printed advertisement, mass media, sales people, like making a phone call, product letters, store visits, and social networks. The third step is the consumer decision with the evaluation of alternatives. So the online marketing communication that support the evaluation of the alternative, including the search engine, online catalog, site visit, product reviews, user evaluation, and social. Comparing the product is not listed here, but I think it's quite important for electronic products, computer, laptops. They are quite important to compare each other. But the offline communication will support the evaluation of reference groups, opinion leaders, mass media, product writers, store visit, and social networks. Usually you can see some magazine also showing the rating of the products. The fourth step is the consumer decision to buy, to purchase. And the online marketing communication that support purchase include online promotions, discounts, targeted email, flash sales, offline marketing communication that support the purchases, including the promotions, direct mail, mass media, print media. And the last step is the consumer decision in the post-purchase behavior, which is loyalty. So the online marketing communication that support post-purchase behavior will include communities of consumption, newsletter, customer email, online updates, social networks to show that there is a new update, and so on. The offline can include warranties, service sell, service calls, parts and repair, consumer groups, and social network also. So let's discuss the online purchasing decision. Right. So the decision process is similar to the online and offline behavior. The online behavior in general will include user characteristic, product characteristic, website features, latency, usability, and security. And attitude towards online purchasing, they are pro or against. And there should be a perception about controlling over the web environment. And also an analysis of clickstream behavior. So you can see from this picture, a general model of the online consumer behavior. So the decision to purchase is shaped by background demographic factors, several intervening factors, and finally influenced greatly by clickstream behavior, very near to the precise moment of purchase. So this figure, there is a user characteristic that influence online consumer behavior, such as culture, social norm, psychological factors, and background demographic factors. The intervening factors that include online consumer behavior, such as brand, marketing, communication stimuli, company capabilities, website, mobile platform features, and consumer skills, product characteristic, purchasing attitude, perceived behavior control, and social networks. And the decision to purchase is influenced by clickstream behavior, very near to the purchase. As a shoppers, you have to differentiate between browsers and buyers. So shoppers are usually among 90% of the internet users. They have an experience shopping online. Out of this 90%, around 80% are the buyers, and 13% are browsers. They just purchase offline. They just browsing the internet to see the products that they like, but they want to touch it in the offline purchase. So the online research influenced about 2.6 trillion, not billion, not million, in retail purchase in 2017. And the online traffic also influenced by offline brands and shopping, improving the online shopping. The e-commerce and traditional commerce are coupled. They are part of the continuum consuming behaviors influencing each other, although there might be some pure play which is focusing only on the e-commerce without any traditional commerce background. So what consumers shop and then buy online? There is a big ticket items which is more than $1,000, around 4,000 Saudi riyals, including computer, hardware, electronics, smartphones, that the consumers now more confident in purchasing costlier items, expensive one. And then there are some small ticket items which is cheaper, much cheaper, $100 or less than 400 Saudi riyals, such as books, office supplies, software, apparels, and so on. And there are also sales of the bulky goods, furniture and large appliance, which is rapidly expanding, like what you found in IKEA and so on. So how do consumers shop? First, you have to understand shoppers finding online vendors. That is highly intentional, goal-oriented search engine marketplaces such as Amazon, eBay, or from specific retail site. And about 8% of the internet users don't shop online. They use trust factors. They are based on hassle factors, which is they have to pay more on the shipping cost, return cost, and so on. But mainly I think about the trust factor, because they might fear that they will lose the money, but they will not get the product. Right? For return, sometimes it's shipping also sometimes is free, like in the coronavirus situation now, most of shopping online make it free delivery service, right? But sometimes the product is different from the one they advertised, so that's why it's part of the trust factor. Including myself, I experienced buying from Noon, the product that I received is different from the picture in the app. So I don't want to return because it's hassle, wasting time. So it reduced my trust factor on the shopping online. Although the shipping is free, but I still want to see the product and buy offline. So to sum up, there are two most important factors shaping decision to purchase online. The first one is utility, because there are more discounts, promotion, better price if it is online. But it does not be always like that. For food, for example, I saw it's more expensive if you buy online. And then it's more convenient. You don't have to change your clothes. Right now, you're just sleeping on your bed watching my lecture. It's very convenient. You just click, tap, and they will come to your house in front of your door. And it's speedy, right? Most of the e-commerce, especially like food, then they give you timed, promised time to arrive in your house, right? And then they give you some estimation when you will deliver the product. If it is in the same city, they will deliver it the same day. If it is different city, you have to drive. Right. And then the second important factor is trust. There is a perception of credibility, whether they are credible or not, they will steal your money or not, like the one I experienced with Noon. And then easy of use, ease of use, don't have too many steps, and perceive risk, the risk that you might lose your money. And the sellers will develop the trust by building strong reputations. That's why if there is a problem, they want to follow up. If there is a complaint on the Play Store, App Store, they want to follow up to increase the ratings, right? Honesty is good in Saudi Arabia, but sometimes they are careless. They don't deliver on time, or the management is not good, and then it's not fair for them to buy the product online compared to the offline, that the online they just don't receive some promotion like in the offline, or there is no follow-up. So this kind of reputation is quite important. If they think that it's not fair to get the product which is not a good product, broken product, slow delivery, so this kind of factors influencing the influencing the perception of trust. And then for digital commerce marketing and advertising, there are some strategies that you have to understand, including the tools to implement the strategy. So there are some features of the internet marketing that you can compare to the traditional, right? So in internet, more personalized than traditional marketing, and it's more participatory compared to traditional marketing, because the customer, the lead can participate more, to comment, to make reviews, to make likes, right? And it's more peer-to-peer, because not like in traditional, one market sales, the salesman, the marketers, they contact many customers, but this one can be peer-to-peer, one-to-one. And it's more communal to the community. You can enter the with this advertisement. you can choose whether you are attacking the advertisement to the young generation, males, or the students, community. You can target based on the profiling in the social media. And the most effective internet marketing is for features, personalization, participation, peer-to-peer, and community, communal. In your marketing plan, you can have multi-channel through website and through traditional online marketing. In the traditional online marketing, can be a search engine, display, email, or affiliation program. To the social marketing, which is the modern online marketing, through social networks, blogs, videos, in YouTube, in Instagram, and through the games, right? And then there is a mobile marketing through some apps, or maybe mobile websites, tablet websites. The browsers is different. And the last one is through the offline marketing and the offline shopping, through the televisions, radio, newspapers, but not so much these days. Television, radio is still there, or maybe from the barrio or the screens on the streets, you can see this kind of offline marketing as well. So still there are some strategic issues and questions that you need to handle. The first one is that which part of the marketing plan should you focus on first, whether you focus on the traditional or you want social media or the offline marketing, right? And then how do you integrate the different platforms for a coherent message? And how do you allocate the money, the resource for marketing? How do you measure and compare metrics from different platforms? And how much is the successful rate and so on? And how do you lead to the sales revenues is part of the issues that you have to handle. And then you need to establish the customer relationship through the website functions to establish the brand and customer expectation by differentiating the product, or maybe to anchor the brand online by using the central point for all marketing messages. And then you can use website to inform the customers and to educate the customers about the products. The best education can be comparing and information more about the use of the products and the benefits of the products. And it also can shape the customer experience inside the websites, because there are many good techniques in the website to increase the user experience. Online marketing and advertising can be through the display, search, mobile messaging, sponsorship, classified, lead generation, converting from lead to customers, and emails. The advantages is you are targeting a young generation from 18 to 34, right? Because they are the most online audience in internet. The rest, they might be not online and connected as others. For me, for example, I'm already more than 34 years old, so I use my mobile so much. If they WhatsApp from you, usually it's ready for me to reply. And there is an advertisement targeting to individuals compared to the offline. And then there is a price discrimination, different price for different customers. And then there's a personalization of the products, such as Dell computers, you can personalize for your shopping. In the traditional online marketing and advertising tools, you can use search engine marketing and advertising, which is appearing on Google, Bing, or DuckDuckGo, right? There is a display advertising marketing, email marketing, there's affiliate marketing program, there's a viral marketing, there's lead generation marketing to the customer. Let's discuss one by one the search engine marketing and advertising. So you can use search engine marketing by using the search engine for branding. And then you can use search engine advertising to use the search engine to support the direct sales. There are two types of the search and advertisement, the paid inclusion and pay per click PPC search advertisement that you have to pay based on the keyword advertising or network keyword advertising, which is context advertising based on the context, not just keyword searching. And because search engine becoming popular, then there's a technique to optimize the search engine through SEO, right? So before you do this SEO, you have to understand the algorithm in the some search engine, such as in Google, right? So they are using the basic algorithm of the software algorithms, right? And then they improve it into more efficient to make the first page is the most related to the search. Or you can use social search, which is using the social network, utilizing the social context, starting from the mobile phone until in the social media. And you can map as a social graph that is providing fewer results and more relevant results as a tree, as a graph, sorry. By using search engine, there are some issues such as paid inclusion and placement practice that they are not related to the keywords, they are not related to the search, but because they pay more, they appear on top. And then there is a link farming, content farming, and there's a click fraud to make it popular. You click it, but it doesn't show you the content that you search. They just containing a lot of keywords that possibly make it a wrong search. And there's a display ad marketing as a banner advertisement. And there's a rich media advertisement as an interstitial advertisement. Can be also a video advertisement, which is more effective than other display formats because they include more information, and moving is sometimes giving more perception. And there is sponsorships as sponsors in some events, and there is native advertising as a showing the native products. In this marketing, you have content marketing, then you have advertising networks, and you have advertisement exchange from one advertisement and another advertisement. And you have programmatic advertising and real-time bidding, RTB. And there are some issues in the display advertising, such as advertisement fraud, viewability, and advertisement blocking. In some apps, you can have some block advertisement. So this picture gives you how to advertise the networks, because millions of publishers have audience to sell and pages to fill with the advertisement. So there are thousands of advertisers who are looking for audience. So these ad networks are like intermediaries that connect publishers and marketers. So this model gives you illustration how the advertising network model from the first step is the consumer request the web page from the advertisement network member merchant site. Second step is that merchant site, merchant server connects to the advertisement network advertisement server, and the advertisement network's advertisement server connect with the profile, user profile database. And then the third step is that the advertisement server reads the of the contact, the client of the customer computers or device, and database for the profile of the customer. And the fourth step is that the advertisement server select and serve user an appropriate display based on the profile of the user. If it's young profile, it will show you the display of sport, for example. If you like some gaming, they'll provide you the profile of advertise video games, mobile games, and so on. And the last step is that you can have the advertisement network following the consumer from the site to site through the use of the tracking files. There are many files there. You can track one by one. And then we have email marketing, which is give you direct email marketing. So the messages sent directly to emails of the user account that interested to the product. So the benefit here is that they are inexpensive, and then a rate around 3% to 4% click throughs, because they just read the emails and then they will buy through this click. And measures the and tracking the response easily, they can give this kind of link to contact and response the activity of the customers in the inside the email. And there is a personalization on the user based on demographic and the targeting of the specific group of the customer. There are three main challenges: spamming. There are a lot of spam emails that if you are at trying to direct email marketing, there is a possibility that they put your email in the spam folder. So you have to understand the anti-spam software, how it works to make your email not considered as a spam email. And then the last challenge is that poorly targeted purchased email list, that they are not really targeted consumers. So in details about spam, what is spam? Spam is unsolicited, unwanted commercial email. Around 15% of all email in 2017. So you can see more than half of email that received is actually spam. Most spam from the bot networks, from the robots in internet. And there are already some efforts to control the spam to make it not so much. But they failed from government regulation, from canned spam, from the state laws in US, and there is a voluntary self-regulation by the industry through the DMA, through the Association of the Digital Manufacturing. In Canada, there is a stringent anti-spam laws to protect people not get annoyed because they respect the citizens so much. And other types of the traditional online marketing, through the affiliate marketing, that they can have the commission fee paid to other website for sending the customer to their website. This is a cooperation affiliating program. There is a viral marketing, that marketing designed to inspire the customers to pass the message to each other. And there is lead generation marketing that gets the service and tools for collecting, managing, and converting the leads. Then for social, mobile, local marketing advertising. The social marketing and advertising using the online social networks and communities. And for mobile marketing and advertising, they use the mobile platform, which influence mobile apps. Like right now, there is most of the people using the mobile apps. And it's targeting local marketing through the geo-targeting and display advertisement in hyperlocal publications. And you can use some coupons that can share each other. And there is another kind of marketing, which is multi-channel. This is the integration between online and offline marketing. So they can increase the percentage of the media consumers using the several media at once. And they reinforce the branding message across media, and the most effective multi-channel campaigns use consistent imagery across media. So let's see the video again about Nielsen online campaign ratings. And as usual, you can answer the bonus question in the chat.
buy it here. Turn it off.
Here's the problem with online ads. How do you know who really sees them? Here's the answer. Nielsen has a way to turn impressions into a clearer picture of your audience without compromising their privacy. Here's how it works. Your ad gets a Nielsen tag. Thousands view your ad. Through the tag, Nielsen records what's being viewed and by how many. The tag also pings major online publishers who take their data of who's viewing the ad, although the sites never see it or know where it ran, and send the data to a calibration engine. Here, Nielsen fuses the who with the what and the how many, creating a more detailed profile of the types of people who viewed your ad, which enables us to deliver online campaign ratings comparable to TV and other media. Featuring key metrics such as reach, frequency, and GRP, with results that can be organized by various criteria, including deeper data sets for marketing mix models, all in reports that can be generated in just days, meaning you get direct in-flight feedback, better campaign measurement, a common approach for online TV, and ultimately improved marketing ROI, plus clearer audience insights without compromising privacy. Find out how Nielsen can deliver online campaign ratings for you.
Well, welcome everyone, and thanks very much for joining us. My name is Steve Hasker from the Nielsen Company, and it's a great pleasure to be able to be in front of you today and introduce Nielsen's online campaign ratings. At Nielsen, we have a two-part business, and the first part of that strategy is to improve all forms of measurement within and across TV, online, and mobile. And the second part is to help our advertising clients and our media clients improve the effectiveness of their advertising. Online campaign ratings is a very big step. Next to me is Mike Murphy from Facebook. Next to Mike is Joel Willenfeld from Moxie. Next to Joel is Susie Deering from Verizon. Next to Susie is Kate Serkin from Starcom MediaVest. And next to Kate is Ari Paparo from Nielsen. I want to make one comment, one extra comment on a panelist who's not with us today, and that's Lucas Watson from PNG. Lucas and his wife are expecting a baby any minute now, and he felt it inappropriate to fly to New York and enjoy it. So he's with us in spirit, and Kate will make a few comments about Lucas and about Procter and about how they think about this. So what we're going to do with the next few minutes is be quiet. Ari is going to stand up and walk you in brief through the product and give you a sense for what it is and how it works. We're then going to ask Mike to give the publisher a point of view. So he's going to stand up on behalf of Facebook, but also online players more generally and talk about that. And then Kate is going to say a few words about the advertiser perspective and the agency perspective of Nielsen's online campaign ratings. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce Ari.
Thanks, Steve. I've been very passionate about online advertising and about online advertising measurement for years. And so the opportunity to improve the ability to measure online, especially with respect to brand advertising, is something that I think is really exciting. And that's why what we're talking about here, the online campaign report, is especially groundbreaking. Over the next 2 days at Mix and over the Advertising Week, you're going to hear a lot of people. I imagine if you keep count, it's almost like a drinking game. You know, take a shot every time someone says online isn't getting its fair share of advertising dollars. I guess probably somewhere around 15 to 20 would be my over-under. And then the second thing you're going to hear over and over again is that brand advertisers are reluctant to spend online because of, among other things, measurement. Among other things, the question of what are the metrics mean? How do I compare them to online? How do I compare them to other media? So what we're trying to address here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to play a short video video that explains the concept. And since the video will probably be very self-explanatory, I'm going to spend about 3 or 4 minutes explaining it afterwards.
Here's the problem with online ads. How do you know who really sees them? Here's the answer. Nielsen has a way to turn impressions into a clearer picture of your audience without compromising your privacy. Here's how it works. Your ad gets a Nielsen tag. Thousands view your ad. Through the tag, Nielsen records what's being viewed and by how many. The tag also pings major online publishers who take their data of who's viewing the ad, although the sites never see it, know where it ran, and send the data to the calibration engine. Here, Nielsen fuses the who with the what and the how many, creating a more detailed profile of the types of people who viewed your ad, which enables us to deliver online campaign ratings comparable to TV and other media. Featuring key metrics such as reach, frequency, and GRP, with results that can be organized by various criteria, including deeper data sets for marketing mix models, all in reports that can be generated in just days. Meaning you get direct in-flight feedback, better campaign measurement, a common approach for online and TV, and ultimately improved marketing ROI, plus clearer audience insights without compromising privacy. Find out how Nielsen can deliver online campaign ratings for you.
So, online campaign ratings. Often people say, well, I can already measure everything online. I can measure through my gross volume on impressions, or I can get a report saying roughly what audience I reached. So this is a change in for the ability to measure audiences. It's really important because most of what's available currently is the ability to measure, 30 days after a campaign runs with a minimum of a very large campaign size with a limited ability to slice and dice the data. So the three really distinguishing characteristics of this program, I think, take it from being a nice app to a real important part of the brand ecosystem, are accuracy, timeliness, and the scalability of the program. So I'll talk briefly about each of those three. First, accuracy. So panel-based measurement, as everyone knows, is very accurate, but also has error rates, and the error rates vary depending on the size of the campaign. Through our new methodology, we've already seen a 14% improvement of accuracy of measurement versus a panel-only approach in an online measurement context. So that makes a really big difference when you're looking at these numbers every day to make decisions to understand the value of media. Second is timeliness. Post-campaign reporting is used to understand how to plan your next media campaign. It's not in flight to change the way decisions you're making and to optimize campaigns. So being able to deliver audience data in flight on a daily basis is an order of magnitude change to what's been available previously. And finally, the scalability. So sample size is always a problem with any type of measurement. And being able to do audience measurement on much smaller campaigns that are using all the advanced techniques of targeting and other online is a requirement to be able to count on online audience measurement. So the system we've developed works on dramatically smaller sample sizes than any other system that's entirely panel-based. So with that, I have one scary chart. So when an ad is run on a website, any website, there are different ways to measure it. So the top measurement, census measurement, is a pixel. So Nielsen records total volume of impressions that are seen by a given ad. That's straightforward. And the bottom measurement is also straightforward. As probably everyone knows, Nielsen has opt-in panelists across TV and PC that allow us to measure the audience of an online ad. So that exists currently. That is the backbone of this system. But what's unique here is that we are also working with third-party publishers, such as Facebook, to, in real time, make decisions about which audiences were seen on the given impression. So the ad is requesting a pixel from Facebook. Facebook is aggregating on a totally anonymous basis the impressions by demographic, by age and by gender. And it goes into this audience calibration engine that takes the total aggregates from our publishers along with the aggregates from our census measurement and the aggregates from our panel and combines them into one report of reach and frequency by demographic group. That allows the advertiser to see at a very accurate level who is being exposed to a given campaign. So the calibration engine is a unique technology we've developed that is all working on aggregate data, no individual data, not even PII, no individual data at all. And that information is then compiled into our online campaign rating. I'm available for more questions after the panelists and also after this entire session to talk about it in more depth. But the way it works is kind of a very important part to why it's different from what's come before. So with that, I'll stop talking about the details and go, and I'm happy to introduce Mike Murphy from Facebook.
Thank you. It's an exciting time to be in the advertising industry as more and more marketers are looking to shift from the information web to a social web and create some really interesting opportunities. As marketers are looking to reach people instead of just eyeballs, the opportunity continues to get better and better with regard to creating cross-platform integrated opportunities. Old analog metrics like impressions and clicks aren't doing anybody a favor in the marketing community. So with Nielsen and with this project, it's really important that we come together and come up with something more, you know, a simpler process that both planners, strategic agencies, and media agencies can use. Last year on this stage, we announced our first relationship with Nielsen, a product called Brandla. Since then, we've done well over 200 studies together where we've seen significant changes in the way that we measure performance and are finding more and more ways for marketers to do the same. And we believe this is a great opportunity for us and for publishers. We look very forward to working with our agency partners and also the brands to come up with something meaningful here and are excited to be a part of it. Next up, Kate Serkin from Starcom MediaVest to give a perspective from both the client and the agency.
The challenges of digital measurement. It seems so simple, isn't it? Digital is the ultimate measurable media that we all have. Everything's tracked, right? So I know none of us are so naive in this audience this morning, but what does the digital ad buying and selling process look like? Why is it not so simple? Why is it hard to measure? And why is this Nielsen and Facebook announcement so important today? This is why. We plan, buy, and post on different metrics in the online world. I want to acknowledge, first of all, the work that the Council for Research Excellence has done. This is a chart that I've taken from a recent education program that they ran. The CRE is a Nielsen-funded organization working to improve all audience measurements. It's independent from Nielsen, but obviously we share the results back with Nielsen with a view to improve audience measurements over time. And the CRE recently presented this to a group of Nielsen clients as part of its education role. And I think the chart sums up the problem perfectly. The primary currency for digital sales is the ad impression, as we all know. Plans are developed right now in all kinds of systems and agencies and ad.
It's already done now in graphic, so let's continue inshallah the video on Thursday, and don't forget to submit your assignments before Thursday. I think just check Blackboard, submit to the Blackboard. Any question from you?
No, doctor.
Okay, see you inshallah on Thursday. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Doctor.
Okay.
Yeah. Doctor, we send the answers on the Blackboard or what?
Video next on Thursday, inshallah.
Ah, that's the assignment, okay.
The assignment on Blackboard.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
You just click the link and you can submit your file.
Okay.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum.